Okay, hey everyone. Thanks to be here for this talk about Kotlin coroutines and how to manage parallelism. So let's start immediately with the slides. So let me share my screen. Okay, and let's go. Okay, so this talk will talk about parallelism using Kotlin coroutines. So let's start immediately with a simple example. So the first subject is the main dispatcher. So let's start with an example that doesn't use coroutines. It's quite basic. So it's just an activity with the text view in the layout, and there are two thread.sleep, and we are updating the text view in the layout after the sleep. Of course, running this activity, we'll see a really nice white screen for 4 seconds and then just a tree because the thread.sleep blocks the main thread. So Android cannot repaint the user interface, so there is just a white page, a white screen. We can improve this code, of course, using Kotlin coroutines. So we can use the delay function. Delay is a standard Kotlin coroutine method that can be used to just suspend for 2 seconds, in this case, the main thread. So delay is something like sleep, thread.sleep, with an important difference that delay just suspend the main thread. And we have to invoke it on a lifecycle scope. Lifecycle scope is something defined in the KTX library. So running this example again, we can see one after 2 seconds, two after 2 seconds, three. Because of course, the main thread is just suspended for 2 seconds. So lifecycle scope uses by default the main dispatcher. If we take a look to the internals of this class, we can see that the main dispatcher is created using standard Android concepts like the main looper and like the enhandler and post delayed. So these are methods that are available on Android from the first version, I think, even before. So this code that it seems a bit magic, under the hood is just something like an handler with two post delayed. But of course, using the coroutines, we don't see the callbacks. So the coroutines are primarily a really good way to avoid using callbacks because the code, even if it's asynchronous under the hood, and we can recognize thanks to the icon next to delay that we can see it in Android Studio, the code is just asynchronous code. Okay, of course, we can do something more interesting than just a delay using coroutines. So let's start talking about a really important concept that is main safety. In this blog post written by Sean McKillan almost 1 year ago, there is an important concept that is main safety. In Kotlin coroutines, well-written suspend functions are always safe to call from the main thread. They are safe to call because, of course, even if there is something that blocks the thread is not blocked, but is just suspended. This is not something required, but it can be really useful to simplify our code. So if we use retrofit, we can define suspending functions that just returns some values. And the suspending function defined using retrofit are already main safe. Here, this example, we'll use it in all the presentation. It's a retrofit service to use the Stack Overflow API. There are three methods. The first one is used to fetch all the users. The second one is to fetch the badges of the user, and the third one to fetch the tags of the user. So for the top users, and then we can fetch badges and tags. In case we are writing some code that can't be executed on the main thread, we have to define it as main safe by ourselves. So in this example, for example, we are reading a file from the file system, and it's better to avoid doing it in the main thread. So to make this method main safe, we can just add a with context dispatcher.io at the beginning of the methods, and then we can define it as suspending. So in this way, we are sure that it's executed on a coroutine context, on a coroutine, thanks to the suspending method. We get a compilation error if we try to do it in a normal thread, let's say. And we are sure that the method will be always invoked on the dispatchers.on an IO thread, thanks to the with context. So this method is main safe. So this method, for example, can be used from a view model scope. It's a KTX method available on Android that is connected to the view model scope. And so, for example, here we can load something from the storage. It's a suspending function. Then we can use the value if it's available, or we can fetch something from the network, save to the storage, and then use the new data. In this case, ViewModelScope uses the main dispatcher. So if we add the println here, this print is executed in the main thread. Because, of course, we start from the main thread, then when there is a suspending method, we are using a background thread, an IO thread, an IO dispatcher to execute something without blocking the main thread, suspending the main thread, and then we go back to the main thread. But in this method, we are going back and forth from the main thread to an IO thread. That probably it's not a big overhead, but we can improve it if we want it, just using a single with context at the beginning of the method. So again, here, we are executing the same stuff, but we are not going back to the main thread because it's not necessary in this case. And we are just executing stuff on the IO thread. When we have the result, we go back to the main thread because the view model scope by default uses the main thread, and everything works without going back and forth. Okay, so let's extract a method, for example, a fed top user method that just uses the API and returns just the first user. So this is a suspending function because it's using a suspending method, and we are using it from the view model, for example. Here we are just fetching the basic data for the user for the top user. If we want to use the API to retrieve more data, we can write something similar. So we have the user, we can invoke fetch pages to retrieve the pages, and then fetch tags to retrieve the tags, and return a user stats that is just a data class that contains everything. Of course, we are using three suspending functions, and by default, the suspending functions are executed in a sequential way, one after the other. This method, this talk is about parallelism, but we'll talk about it in a moment. The same method can be written, of course, using other frameworks like RxJava. This talk is not about the difference between RxJava and coroutines, just a single note that this is quite complicated using RxJava because we have to use map, flat map, and nested map and flat maps. So it can be quite complicated. And instead, with the coroutines, we have just a single method that it's the same method that we can write to use synchronous code. Okay, so let's talk about async, that is a really important method in the coroutine world. So first of all, concurrency versus parallelism. This is there two concepts that are in the asynchronous world, say in the concurrent programming. It's not just about the coroutines. So searching on Google, we can find a good definition that is concurrency is when two tasks can start, run, and complete in overlapping time periods. Parallelism is when tasks literally run at the same times, for example, on a multi-core processor. So there are two concepts that are similar but different, let's say. You can find some better explanation on the web. So let's go back to our method. Here we don't have parallelism. Probably we have concurrency between this method and the method that updates the UI. However, in this method by itself, everything is sequential with suspending methods. If we want to execute, but looking at the code, of course, the badges and the tags can be retrieved in parallel because they are they are not related to each other. So here we can use an async to execute the two calls in parallel. So here it's the important stuff. So we have async that just starts the first fetch badges async operation. Then there are the second async that starts the second asynchronous operation to fetch the tags. And then we have two deferred objects, and we can invoke the await method to retrieve the value or an exception on the first and on the second one. Of course, the call starts on the async by default, so they are not lazy. So in this way, we are executing two operations in parallel because, of course, they are starting on the async. So when we await for the first one, the two operations are already running in background. Okay, the coroutine scope invocation at the beginning of the method is useful to connect the two asynchronous operations. We'll see better in a moment. Okay, of course, we say that retrofit methods are main safe. What happens if we are not using main safe method with async? For example, a thread.sleep is not the main safe method because just blocks the main thread. So this is just a similar example using coroutine scope and then to sleep executed with async. The idea is that using async stuff is executing parallel, but it's not so easy because here the async are using the dispatcher from the parent, so they are using the main dispatcher because view model scope uses by default the main dispatcher. So when we are using async, we are just scheduling something using the main dispatcher, and the main dispatcher manages just a single thread, so it can do miracles, and it just execute the two thread.sleep on the main thread. So it's blocking the main thread, and that's bad, and we get the result after 2 seconds. So even executing async, we have to pay attention to the dispatcher. Of course, we can fix this problem, for example, using dispatches.io in the viewmodel scope. This way, the async will use dispatches.io because they use the parent scope dispatcher. And so dispatches.io manages the thread pool. So when we execute async, the two operations are scheduled in two different threads. And so the total duration is just 1 second, as expected. Of course, we can move the dispatches.io from the view model scope to the async block, and we get the same result. But this is, we have to define the dispatcher because we are using thread.sleep that are not main safe. The real way to fix this code is using a main safe function that is, of course, delay. So using delay, that is the main safe function, but here we can use also retrofit function or every main safe function, we can just use this code without specifying the dispatchers at all, because it just works. This is one of the reasons why main safety is a good concept to follow using coroutines. So it works even without main safe functions, but the code usually it's easier to read. Because, of course, here we have still the main dispatcher with a single thread, but we are using main safe function that suspend the main thread, and the result is just a second, just 1 second. So let's go back to the async method. This is the definition of the method in the coroutines library. It's an extension function of coroutine scope, so we need a coroutine scope to execute something in parallel. And there is something really, really important, that is this phrase here in the documentation, that is, it cancels the parent job or outer scope on failure. So we have to pay attention on this phrase. So let's go back to our example. So here we have a view model scope, then we have the coroutine scope with two async and the try catch. The try catch outside the coroutine scope. So we can model it in this way, probably. So if there is an exception in the fetch badges, we saw from the documentation that it fails the parent scope. Here, the parent scope is coroutine scope. So it will cancel the coroutine scope, and so the coroutine scope will cancel all the children that are still running, in this case fetch tags, and then the coroutine scope will fail itself and will throw an exception, but that is caught by the try, and so the error is shown by catch. So in this way it works basically. And it works then to the coroutine scope. The coroutine scope, as I said before, it's useful to connect the two calls. So in case of an error on a call, the other call or calls, because we can have multiple async here, are cancelled automatically by the coroutine scope, basically. But this code can be written even without the coroutine scope. And probably it's easier to read because it's something like this one, because we are already inside the ViewModel scope. Coroutine scope, so we can use async directly on the view model scope. This code works if there are no exceptions. Doesn't work so good if there is an exception, because as I said before, if there is an exception here, the main scope is cancelled. The parent scope, sorry, is cancelled. Here, the parent scope is view model scope. So the try catch is ignored. And then the exception is managed by the default coroutine exception handler that on Android uses a class that uses the kill application handler. And you can imagine that the kill application handler will kill your application. So this code that seems good, there is a try catch, will crash your application. You have to pay attention to use the coroutine scope outside to group the two async calls. Okay, another way to fix it is to use a run catching or a try catch inside the two async block. So we are not returning a deferred of the object, but a deferred of the response or an either or something similar, or a simple data class of the object. And then we have to check if it's failure or if it's success. So this works because it doesn't crash, but there is a problem that in case of an error, the coroutines framework doesn't know that there is an error because we are catching it inside the async. So the other call is not cancelled. So if the badges fails after 1 second and the tags fails after 10 seconds, we have to wait for 10 seconds, even if after 1 second we know that there is an error. Okay, something similar can be in another class if we want to use the coroutine scope in another class. Usually it's not necessary because the KTX coroutine scopes are enough in many cases. But if you need another scope, you can define your class as an implementation of coroutine scope. And in this way, it doesn't work because you have the same problem that you had before, because you are using async on a top level scope. Here again, the best way to do it is to use the coroutine scope function to create a nested scope. So the two async are connected and the exception are managed in the right way. So my suggestion is to always use the scope as a field in the class and never implement coroutine scope in the class, because it's easier to write the right code in case of async operation. Okay, so let's go to this example. Let's say that we want to add the try catch. The try catch can be added inside or outside the coroutine scope. Adding it inside the coroutine scope invocation, there is the same problem that we saw before. So if there is an exception in fetch pages or fetch tags, then the parent coroutine scope is cancelled, and the try catch basically is bypassed. So then the coroutine scope will throw an exception. And again, our friend, the kill application handler, will manage the exception, killing the application. So this code is wrong, but it's quite easy to fix it. We can just use the try catch outside the coroutine scope, because in this way we catch the exception of the coroutine scope. So there is an error in fetch badges that fail the coroutine scope. The coroutine scope cancels the other children that are still running, and then we can catch the exception and do whatever we want. Okay, I wrote a blog post around 1 year ago about this subject, if you are interested. Okay, let's go. Next subject, async versus launch. These two methods are the most coroutines, most famous coroutine methods, probably. And there are a lot of documentation on Stack Overflow or blog post about the difference between these two methods, because they are quite similar looking at the code base. There is launch is it returns the job, while async returns the thread. So async can be used to get the return value from the background task. They are similar, but they are quite different, especially in the usage, because most of the times, launch can be used on a top-level coroutine scope to create a new coroutine, while async can be used in a nested coroutine scope to execute tasks in parallel. So even if they are quite similar and they do something that is quite similar, the usage, I think that it's quite different. Because launch, top level, to enter the coroutine world, async in a nested coroutine scope to manage parallelism, to execute something in parallel. Of course, there are exceptions, so this is true most of the time. For example, reading blog posts about launch, usually launch is considered something to use to execute something fire and forget. So let's say that here we fetch the top user, then we want to save in the database, but we want to show the user while we are saving in the database. So we don't want to wait for the save to complete. So the idea is to use a launch, of course. And something similar, we need a coroutine scope and then we need launch. This seems good code, but if we take a look to the coroutine scope documentation, there is this phrase that says that the function returns when all its children coroutines are completed. So going back to the example, this launch is useless because the suspending function top users doesn't return until the launch is terminated. So it's basically useless. If we want to do something fire and forget here, if we want really to forget it, we need to use another scope. So we can use launch on another scope, so it's not connected to the suspending function anymore. So the top user are returned before, while we are saving on the storage. And of course, we need a try catch here to manage the exceptions. Okay, another exception to the rule that I said is if we want to pre-cache something. I said that it's async is useful on a nested coroutine scope. Instead, here, if we want to pre-cache the api.fetchTopUsers API REST API server call, we can use an async on the top-level scope. So we can use another external field defined as viewModelScope.async. This deferred is created when the class is created, of course. So it starts when the class is created. When the load is invoked, so even, for example, on a click list or something else later, we are invoking a wait on the same deferred. So we get the value that it's already there, or we wait for the response if the server call is still running, or we get the exception if there is an exception. So in this way, we can easily pre-cache something. And I think that it's one of the few exceptions when it makes sense to use async on a top-level scope, not on a nested scope. Okay, so next example, last example, is to use select. This method is not one of the most famous coroutines method, but can be useful in some times. So this is the example. Let's say that we want to manage loading something from a server API and caching the data. And we want to have the best of both worlds, let's say. So in case of the initial loading, of course, we don't have anything in the cache. So we show a loading message and then the data from the server. In case the network is fast, we want to show the the data from the network because we are sure that they are up to date. So we show the loading and then the data from the server that we get fast. Instead, if the network is low, we want to show something, but we don't want to wait for a timeout, for example. So we start the server call. If after 2 seconds the data are not available, we show the data from the cache. Then when we retrieve the data, we get the data from the server, we update the UI, we show a snack bar and a nice animation to show the new data from the server. In this way, we are quite sure to show up-to-date data and to have a good or decent offline support because the user will wait at most 2 seconds before reading something. We can implement it using coroutines. For example, the most easy implementation is using with timeout. So with timeout of 2 seconds, we invoke the top user function. Then we can use a try catch in case of timeout cancellation exception. We load the data from the storage, from the cache, and we update the UI with the data from the cache. And we start again the call to the server. In case the connection is slow, we'll update the UI with the new data when we have got it. In case of an exception, a real exception, retrieving the data, we load the data from the data from the cache. If it's available, we show the data from the cache, or we show an error message because we don't have any data to show. This solution works, but there is a problem that is in case of a slow connection, we are executing 2 server calls. The first one that it's canceled by with timeout, and then we retrieve later. So it works, but can be improved. So let's try it. First of all, we can create a select class with 3 possible values. So the success, fetch success, fetch error, and timeout. I think it's quite easy. It's just a select class with 3 values. Then we can define an async invocation that try to fetch the user and return fetch success or fetch error in case of an error. Then we can define another async invocation that execute a delay and then return a timeout. And we want basically to execute these 2 async in parallel and have something when the first of the 2 returns. How can we do it? We can do it using the select operation. So select, the syntax, maybe it's a bit weird, however, it returns something when one of the 2 returns. So then we have a result. The result is an instance of the select class, so we can use a when. So if is fetch success, so it's a success before the timeout, we can just cancel the timeout, the delay, and update the UI. If it's a timeout, we can load the data from the cache and update the UI if there is something in the cache. And then we can invoke a wait on the fetch object because the server call is still running in background, so we can just invoke a wait. And in case there is a success, we can update the UI later. In case of a fetch error, we can cancel the timeout because we don't need it anymore. And we can load the data from the storage and update the UI if it's available or show an error message. Okay, so it's not the most beautiful code that you will see in this conference. For sure, it's quite complicated, and probably there are many, many edge cases because there is something that is executed in parallel, so there are classical concurrency problems. The good news is that we can test it really, really easily. So this is, for example, a test. So we have 2 lists, one of the list of the update UI calls and one the list of the show error calls. And we are populating the 2 lists using this lambda. So every time there is an invocation of the update UI, instead of updating the UI, we are just inserting something on the list. And same thing for the show error message. So in this case, for example, we are testing that and there is the storage is empty, so it's null, and there is a response from the network in 1 second, so before the 2 seconds timeout, and we can answer the update UI calls contain exactly new data in 1 second, and the show error calls is empty. Everything works because we are using run blocking test that uses a virtual clock, so we are not to wait for the 1 second delay, and we can retrieve the current time of the virtual clock using current time methods because it's available thanks to run blocking test. So using something similar, we can test all the possible edge cases. So for example, if there is something on the storage and the network is slow, we'll see that the update UI calls contains all data after 2 seconds and new data after 5 seconds. In case there is the storage that is empty and an exception after 1 second, we'll see that update UI call is empty and contains exactly show error calls. So we'll see. We can verify that there is a show error call after 1 second because there is a delay or a 1 second delay. Okay, this was the last example. So wrapping up. Main safe function can be really, really useful to simplify our code, to simplify coroutines code. Usually it's easier to read, to write, and to test it. It's not something mandatory. It works even without using main safe functions, but usually it's better. Then launch and async. Usually we use launch on top level coroutine scope and async in nested coroutine scopes to manage parallelism. So again, there are exceptions, but you have to pay attention when there is an exception. And then talking about exceptions, never catch an exception inside the coroutine scope. That the coroutines are totally wrong and there are a lot of edge cases. That's not true. I think that coroutines are awesome. They are really, really useful and you have just to pay attention to a couple of concepts. Okay, here there are some links. My name is Fabio Collini. I'm an Android developer at the New York Times, even if I'm based in Italy. I'm a Google developer expert for Android and Kotlin. Here there are a couple of links. The first one is the one written by a Googler about main safety, and then there are two articles that I wrote about coroutines. Thanks all. I think that's all. And if there are questions. Okay, just a few questions. So the first one is quite easy. How did you create the nice code example slides? It's just Keynote and copy and paste from Android Studio. So it's quite, and a lot of animation using the magic move on Keynote. Nothing too fancy. And fortunately, Keynote didn't crash during the presentation. Okay, can you please elaborate a little on lifecycle scope, view model scope, coroutine scope? Yeah, sure. So a coroutine scope, not score, probably. Coroutine scope is something, an important concept on the coroutine. It's something similar probably to a composite disposable on RxJava, if you are familiar with it. It manages, there are many, many meanings to the scope. Probably the most important one is that the coroutine executing something, launch or async on the coroutine scope, we are connecting the task to the coroutine scope. So when the scope is cancelled, all the tasks launched in that scope are cancelled. So this is really useful to avoid having manual cancellation, and we are lucky that on Android there are already lifecycle scope and view model scope that are defined on a coroutine on a KTX library, and they are connected and fragment lifecycle, the lifecycle scope, and to the view model scope. So using a launch on that extension function, we don't need to manage the cancellation because they are already connected to the right scope and they are canceled automatically. I'm not sure if it's enough, but I think this can be an answer. I thought that the demodel scope contains a supervisor job that means a child coroutine does not cancel any other coroutine, parent and other children. Demodel scope is another interesting concept. It's true, but it's just the demodel scope, the supervisor job is just used for the children in the view, the direct children in the demodel scope, not for the nested, because the nested scope are created using coroutine scope. So this is a good question. Maybe we can talk about it later on Slack because the answer is not so easy, unfortunately. Sorry, it was answered, but can you explain what, supervisor job. I think that it's something that can be useful sometimes. There are some concepts on the, many concepts on the coroutines, of course, and I just talk about just a couple. So for example, supervisor job and exception handler are two concepts that, in my opinion, are just to manage some edge cases, and we shouldn't use them in the daily job, in our daily code, because they are quite an exception. Supervisor job, if you read the article I wrote about the cancellation and the try catch and the exception, you'll see a better example there. It's quite complicated, but you still have some problem. It doesn't resolve the problems that I was talking about in the talk, basically. Okay, would you say that Rx coroutines are complementary, shouldn't be used to do it all, or do you think one of them will outlast the other? Oh, philosophical question, nice question, but I think I'm more about coroutines. Honestly, even if I talk about Rx for a while, but right now, if you are in the future, I think that coroutines will use more. And I think that a lot of people are using Rx because 3 years ago, 4 years ago, coroutines were not available and Kotlin was not a thing. So basically we are continuing to use Rx because we already know Rx. But if you need to start from scratch right now, I think that coroutines are the better solution. I'm not saying that Rx Java is not a good library because it's amazing. There are a lot of stuff. It's different. It's not easy to compare them. They are two good solutions. I prefer to use coroutines usually lately because the code it's easier. Other people prefer to use Rx Java because probably they are more functional, and that's true, but it's something, they are both good, and I don't know about the future, honestly. I know that Google is using coroutines a lot in the libraries, so there are a lot of KTX library to simplify the coroutines usage, so that can be something to think about. There are no KTX library that uses Rx, or maybe just Room and something else. But it seems that based on what Google is doing, coroutines are more likely to be the future in Android, but we'll see. Does coroutine scope hold the same rule as Rx first applied scope scheduler win? Scope? And about the schedulers and the dispatcher. It's quite different, I think. There isn't the subscribe on and observe on. So when you have a scope, the code inside the scope, it's executed with the dispatcher defining that scope. If it's not defined, it uses the parent scope. So it's quite easier because when you execute something on a scope, you are 100% sure that that code is executed in that scope. Then, of course, if there is an nested scope, there is the same rule. So it's quite different for RX. There isn't observe on, subscribe on, and the same problem that are on RX. I think that the thread management is quite easier on RX jar. Okay, what do you think about Vue Model Scope? It's amazing because you can use it and just use it. You don't care about the cancellation, and it just works. Really good stuff, in my opinion. Then, do you use coroutines in production? Yes, in the New York Times application. My last example about Select. If you open the application right now, you'll see then on top, and you are on a slow network, you'll see that there is a message, then a loading message, then there are the data from the cache, and another message on top, and then the new data. So we are using coroutines in production, not in the whole app, because the application is big, and there is some code that is still using RX Java, of course, but we are using it in production, in a code base that is partially in Kotlin, partially in Java, partially using RX, and partially using coroutines. And even the integration between coroutines and RX Java is really good, because you can have a single, and there is an external library, a JetBrains library of the integration between the two. So you can just invoke dot await on a single, and it becomes a suspending function. So yeah, we are using it in production. Any drawbacks of coroutines? I don't know, maybe because I'm biased. Yeah, probably you can use them only in Kotlin. So if you are using in a code base that contains code in Java, you probably have to do some wrappers. But again, it's easy if you can just use a wrapper of a suspending method that returns a single. It's just using RX single and invoking the other methods. But maybe if it's a mixed code base, Java and Kotlin, but it depends on the code base. Any other drawbacks? I don't know, but maybe I'm not the right person to answer this question. Yeah, probably mixed code base and invoking them in Kotlin. And then probably compared to RX Java, they are quite new. So in the suspending method, async, launch, something similar, everything is already stable. If you are using flows, there are something that is still experimental. That it means that already works because we are using them, but maybe the API will change later. Then, last question, maybe. I'm not sure if we are late. Cancellation management is not that easy, it seems, especially in Vue Model Scope. A word of cancel things to watch out for? No, I think that cancellation management, you need to pay attention to the exceptions, but to the cancellations, yeah, I think that it's straightforward when you have a sequential code, because everything is managed automatically, and you don't have to cancel anything because the Vue Model Scope is automatically destroyed on the onDestroy method of the Vue Model. There is something to pay attention when you have something in parallel, so you have to manage to use the coroutine scope there. But apart from that, you have to pay attention, but not on cancellation. I think it's more on the exception management. Okay, if there aren't any other questions, so let me see in the comments, but doesn't seem so. Okay, I think that's all. If you have any other questions, I'm in Slack. Feel free to reach me there. Okay, thanks a lot for being here, and see you later. Bye.